There was a story in the San Francisco Chronicle that, of course, I forgot to save. But it was about a lady who lived in the good old days, when a century was born and a century had died. And about these good old days, the old lady replied, why, they were just a lot of people doing the best they could. Just a lot of people doing the best they could. And then the lady said that they did it pretty up and walking good. Whatever happened to those faces in the old photographs? I mean the little boys. Boys, hell, they were men who stood knee-deep in the Johnstown mud in the time of that terrible flood. And they listened to the water, that awful noise. And then they put away the dreams that belonged to little boys. Is going down for Mr. Bowie as he's singing with his class of 19-2. Oh, Mother Country, I do love you. Oh, Mother Country, I do love you. I knew a man named E.A. Stewart, spell S-T-U, A-R-T, and he owned some of the finest horses that I think I've ever seen. And he had one favorite, a champion, the old campaigner, and he called her Sweetheart on Parade. She was easily the finest horse that the good Lord ever made. But old E.A. Stewart, he was going blind, and he said, before I go, I gotta drive her one more time. So people came from miles around, and they stood around the ring, but no one said a word. No one said a thing. Then here they come, E.A. Stewart in the wagon right behind, sitting straight and proud, and he's driving her stone blind. And would you look at her, oh, she never looked finer or went better than today. It's E.A. Stewart and the old campaigner, Sweetheart on Parade. And the people cheered. Why, I even saw a grown man break right down and cry. And you know, it was just a little while later that old E.A. Stewart died. The sun, it is going down for Mr. Bowie as he's singing with his class of 19-2. Oh, Mother Country, I do love you. Oh, Mother Country, I do love you.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the latest video in the 172nd Air Wing channel. Let us begin with a moment of gratitude. So the channel has 288 subscribers now. So I want to say thank you to all of you out there who have subscribed and joined the notification list for my channel. I'm very grateful for the support that you all have shown, and I look forward to putting out more videos that everyone likes to review and watch and maybe learn a thing or two about some of these aircraft that many of us, myself included, might not have known before embarking on this project. So thank you for your support, and if you like the content in the channel, please consider subscribing. So with that, let's get into the subject of today's video, which is the F-105D Thunder Chief. So this review will be on the single seat version, which is the D model. I do have the Leo Thorsness Medal of Honor double seat F-105, which is the F-105G, because that one happens to be the Wild Weasel variant. So we will talk about that one in a separate video, because the story behind that airframe is definitely deserving of its own distinct recap and review. So today's video is just going to be about the single seat version, and I have a confession to make on the subject, which is that honestly, I've been kind of procrastinating about this video. I've been putting it off for a while, and it's because of a combination of various things. So, as many of you who have been part of this channel already know, I tend to do quite a bit of homework before doing these video reviews. And that means reading a lot of source material. Some of it is online. Most of it is by print sources. So accounts from pilots, accounts from air crew, accounts from maintainers, and various other individuals that can shed some background on the history of these aircraft that I'm reviewing. So usually the research process is generally not that painful. It does take some time, which is why the period of time that it takes me to make these videos tends to be longer than I would personally like, but that's just the nature of the beast when it comes to researching this stuff. So that is usually, again, not that terrible of a process, but with the F-105, it was a mentally trying thing for me. Being a veteran, I've known people that have served in Iraq and Afghanistan, and when I started researching this airplane, it meant digging into a lot of very old and very painful history with Vietnam and Southeast Asia and that whole theater. And while I was reading all this stuff, a certain thing happened in April of this year involving withdrawal of forces from Afghanistan. And, well, it was a little bit of a trying mental experience reading about the events of Vietnam and, you know, the fall of Saigon and that whole business, and then to see it essentially rhyme and repeat itself in the course of history right in front of me in my living room. It's a bit of a trying mental experience as a veteran to see that all happen. So with all that background laid out, I'd had a plan to put this video out maybe, I want to say, 2 months ago, and I just had to put it aside for a while because it was just too mentally, like, it was just too mentally taxing to consider. And to give you an example of why, there is an account from a pilot who flew one of these F-105s, and unfortunately, like, some of these stories that I picked up in the source material are so outlandish that I completely understand why they don't make movies about this airplane, because no one would believe it. There was a story of an airman who got hit by AAA diving on a target in Hanoi. His F-105 was shot up and on fire, and he was still able to control the airplane long enough to get to within 40 or 50 miles away from the Vietnam-Laotian border, where he was able to eject safely and then get picked up. Like, flying an airplane 7 minutes long with it literally on fire. And that's the kind of thing that generally will get people to laugh at your video production or your movie if you put something like that in it, because that's just preposterous, right? But that actually happened. That was a real life pilot story. There's another pilot who ejected from his F-105 a split second before it blew up because a valve had failed on the internal fuel tank and it streamed fuel out the bottom, and his wingman told him that there was a leak, and essentially he saw from his wingman that he needed to eject right away, which he did, and then a split second later his airplane just exploded when the fire reached the fuel tank. And it's just stories like that were just, it's hard to read that stuff. And then you see the source material, like Ed Rasmus's excellent books. The first one was on his Thud Pilot, his first tour as a Thunder Chief pilot in the Vietnam theater, flying out of Thailand, actually. And then the second time in 1972, his book Palace Cobra, which is when he came back. And while Palace Cobra is about the F-4E and his tour in that airframe, a lot of the things that he reflected on with his second tour were in direct connection to his first tour flying one of these F-105s. So, yeah, reading that stuff was kind of crazy. And some of the stats from that war and that conflict are just insane. Out of 833 of these F-105s built, 382 were lost in Southeast Asia. That, for those of you who aren't necessarily math majors, is a 46% loss rate. Ed Rasmus wrote in one of his passages that when he was stationed with his F-105 squadron, they lost 7 airplanes in a week. I mean, that is a crazy freaking number. 7 people and 7 airplanes going down in a week would be just completely unacceptable in the modern military structure. If we lost 2 airplanes on an operation, it would be cause for some strategic reevaluation of what we were doing. Losing 7, that is an incomprehensibly high loss rate by modern standards. I think we lost 1 airplane in air-to-air combat in Desert Storm, the first Desert Storm, which was the F-18 that got shot down by Jamil Zaihud's MiG-25. One air-to-air shoot down from the enemy. And in Vietnam, we lost 7 airplanes in a week, 7 F-105s going down in a week. And this happened over and over and over, week after week, month after month. If that sort of thing had happened today, I'm not sure what the outcome would have been. Would the pilots have done something out of what the Israeli Air Force once did and just gone on a public strike to protest it? I don't know. But what I can say is something like that today would be completely and totally unacceptable. But these pilots did it week in, week out. At one point in 1964, it was statistically impossible for an F-105 pilot to complete a 100 mission tour without being shot down at least once. Think about that. Think about getting orders to a theater where you know statistically that when you fly this airplane, at least one of your 100 trips are going to end with you riding a parachute. And just living with that day in and day out, every day you strap on that airplane, you have to think that, hey, is today the day that I have to ride the silk? I mean, that's a crazy outlook to have when you approach a job like this. But the men of that time did it, and it's mostly men because at that time we weren't quite enlightened enough to have women in the cockpit at that point. So most of the pronouns in association with the history of this airplane are going to be male, such is history. So that being said, this airplane has quite a history, and I was struggling to try to put it into some format where I could impart the tradition behind this airplane. And honestly, the best that I can do is point you to a resource that lays it out in much greater detail than I possibly could. There is a video called There Is a Way, and there's several F-105 pilots featured in it because it was filmed in 1967, essentially on location. And it was a movie commissioned by the Air Force to, act as a morale boost because of the stats that I've just shared with you. Some people might not feel too hot about going to Southeast Asia if statistically, one of the trips that you're going to fly in your 100 mission tour are going to end with you being shot down. I mean, it's not the kind of thing most people love to sign up for. So there might have been a bit of a morale issue. And the U.S. Air Force commissioned the creation of that video using footage from Tockley Air Base and some other places to create it. And Ed Rasmus is featured in it. Carl Richter, Lieutenant Carl Richter, he's featured in it as well. And he was an F-105 pilot that flew 198 missions. So he did his 100, volunteered for another back-to-back set of 100 missions, and then on his 198th sortie, he got shot down and tragically killed. So it was amazing for somebody who read the source material to see these people talking about their experiences in the moment when it happened. And it makes me wish that GoPro and YouTube and all this cool stuff we have now existed back then, because can you imagine what a selfie of somebody's GoPro footage on a diving run in Hanoi would look like on YouTube today? I mean, that would be trippy. That'd be a trippy thought to consider. So yeah, a lot of history, a lot of heritage, and this particular model from HobbyMaster really captures it pretty well. I did add some weathering to the aircraft, as you may have noticed, and that's something that I do from sometimes on certain models if they have a decent wartime record behind them, because the way I see it, if it was used in conflict, it should look like it was used in conflict. I like to display it that way. I don't necessarily prefer a completely clean airplane when it's got a war history behind it. However, I don't support manufacturers like HobbyMaster adding weathering to an airplane, because they either tend to do it too much, or they don't do it enough, or they don't take the subtlety to it. Like, when you have an airplane like an F-105, it's not uniformly dirtied up, right? There's going to be parts of the airplane that'll have more soot and stuff on it than other parts that won't, right? Like the flaps, that'll be some grime on it, but the forward edge of the wing probably doesn't, right? And most manufacturers, they have a manufacturing process, so they can't really do parts of the airplane that are weathered and parts that aren't. They kind of have to do the whole thing in the same finish or not at all. So with manufacturing realities being what they are, I'm glad that HobbyMaster just doesn't touch weathering. They don't do it, which is good for me, because if there is a project where I feel like some weathering is called for, I can add just the right amount that I feel is worthy of showing the model. And I like the fact that the F-105 looks so cool in its kind of wartime handle business condition like it is now. So this F-105 is a very big model. I will say right now, if you want to include one of these or two of these in your collection, you're going to need to make some space, because she is long. It's a big airplane, obviously, to haul around the capacity of a Boeing B-17, I mean, you're going to need a big airplane to do it. And the F-105, even in 1/72nd scale, is a pretty hefty and large bird. So if you want to add one of these to your collection, you will need to take some space into consideration. So as far as HobbyMaster's model of it, I don't see any objectionable accuracy issues with it. Maybe the paint finish might be a point of contention, the green being the wrong shade potentially in some cases. But for me, Southeast Asian airplanes had a large variation in shade color anyway, which is just how it happens with wartime airplanes, you know. As it turns out, during a shooting war, you know, plane captains and crew chiefs tend to have more important things to do with their day than to make sure that a certain airplane has a compliance with color technical order XYZ or TO-1-6 or what have you. So there's going to be some variation in colors. And in fact, some of the airplanes that I've seen in Southeast Asian colors didn't have any paint at all in some parts. Like the camouflage was worn through and you saw like bare metal or the white underneath in some cases. So, you know, there's some variation there, which means there's some room for subjectiveness in what we all think in terms of appropriate weathering or appropriate colors. So just bear that in mind. But this one, I think, really captures the F-105 look pretty nicely. You do get a accessory for the back, so you are able to run a different speed brake back here, because the nozzle and the speed brake were the same part. So you get one of those and that piece comes off, and then you just put a little piece on that shows the speed brake deployed, and that goes there. You do get in this kit the centerline bombs, which are equipped, two fuel tanks, which are equipped, a centerline fuel tank, which are not equipped in this shot, and two aim nines, which are on the wingtips, and then you also get a QRC 160, which is the ECM pod that goes right about there. So the way those worked is you had an ECM pod that went on the F-105, which helped distract or dislocate, I suppose, SA-2s that were fired at the F-105 formations. So I'm glad to see that HobbyMaster did incorporate that with this kit or this model, and I'm glad to have it on to historically reflect the accuracy of the aircraft. So the other side, it's hard to see, but I have an AIM-9B equipped right about here. So most of the F-105's kills were by guns. So out of the 27, I think most of those were gun kills, maybe one missile kill or two out of that mix. So the F-105 proved a lot of things, which is that guns still definitely had a relevant part of air combat. And the F-105 also proved that you didn't necessarily need the most maneuverable airplane to kill another one. People tend to have this idea that an airplane has to be, like a bat-turning, crazy, freaky airplane, like an SU-27 or SU-35 doing Cobras or whatever. Like, that's the idea that people think when they think of air combat. But a majority of kills that happen in air combat are ambushes. So if you have two F-105s dropping bombs, a couple of MiGs see them and think, oh, easy meat. Well, then the two F-105's wingmen are behind the MiGs, and they go paper down and bye-bye MiG. So most air-to-air kills are ambushes by statistics, and the F-105 bagged quite a few MiGs that weren't paying attention. So I'd like to take a moment to recognize that while the F-105 had the turning circle of the state of Texas, it didn't necessarily matter, because what mattered was being able to look out the window, see the target, and to engage it with an effective weapon system, because the guns on these F-105s were the Vulcan cannons, and most of the time they worked. And they worked a lot more often than the AIM-9Bs or the F-4s, AIM-7s, which tended to not work nearly as often. So the F-105, even though it's oriented more toward the bomber side of the fighter-bomber equation, was still a decently capable fighter. And the 27 kill statistic for how many MiGs these things shot down stands as proof of that. So yeah, as far as the model itself goes, again, I really like the way they did it. And we'll put a comment here that if you are shopping for one of these, the single seat F-105s like the one you see here are discontinued. HobbyMaster changed their tooling, so they only produce the two seat versions. So if you see one of these single seat ones and you really, really want it, you're gonna need to move fast, and it's probably going to be a relatively expensive transaction, because HobbyMaster has not made the single seat in quite some time. So this single seat one is in the colors of the Polish glider, and the actual aircraft is, interestingly enough, on display in Krakow, Poland. So hopefully I didn't butcher the name of that city too much, but the fighter pilot who flew this in combat became a general in the US Air Force, and he was of Polish ancestry. So when the time came to retire these F-105s, he made the arrangements to ensure that the Polish glider, which survived the Vietnam conflict, was appropriately displayed in Krakow, Poland, which is where it exists now. So an absolutely appropriate outcome for an airplane like this. And I'm also glad to have HobbyMaster's 1/72nd scale model of this in my collection. So as far as future updates go, I will be doing a separate review of the F-105 Wild Weasel model, the two-seat version, as flown by Captain Thorsness, the Medal of Honor recipient. So the Weasel's name I do not recall offhand, but I will talk about both of them in my next F-105 video. So if you're looking to get a single-seat F-105, I do recommend picking one of these up if the price is not too dear. Essentially, the price of everything is a lot at this point. But I was shocked to actually find out that my T-38 that I did a video on and paid, I think, $80 for a couple of years back is now selling for like $150. So that just goes to show you that, yeah, everything is pretty much expensive right now, at least at the time of this video. So hopefully when you watch this in the future, the economy is a little bit better and these HobbyMaster models aren't hideously expensive to get. Especially the single seat F-105s. So if you happen to spot one at a good price, I highly recommend picking it up. And thank you for watching to this point in my video. So once again, if you like my content, please consider subscribing so I know that you all think I'm doing a great job. And if you have anything else to add or color to share or historical memories to note with the F-105 and how it impacted your life and your family, please put it in the comment section. I'd love to hear from some of you out there that's got family and relatives who were crew chiefs or worked on this airplane or were civilian support contractors back in the day that kept these old warbirds flying. So please share your stories in the comment section below. Thank you again for watching to this point, and I will catch you all in our next video. Thank you for watching.